inclusion, equity, and diversity in higher education for the world we want to shape. For me, it's quite challenging because all these categories are ethical. And when it comes to the world, we are also very hopeful and we are also striving for a better world. It is in this context, I would like to draw a small analogy saying that while drawing a big picture, we will have to see the smaller ones as well. So the big picture usually is fascinating, is so captivating, but at the same time, we seem to be leaving some of the bylanes and other smaller pictures around the bigger picture. It is in this context, I would like to raise a very basic question. Inclusion, equity, and diversity in higher education poses one major question to me, how this can be done. So you have a methodology, you have a way of going about, you have a framework, you may have so many things, but at the same time, I have been a person all the time, don't look from the top, but from the bottom. It is in this context, I want to take only one small issue from my own country, and I would like to zero down some of the contradictions, some of the implications of it. The National Education Policy for India, just introduced in 2019, envisioned India need to be transformed, and for the transformation, education plays the vital role. Therefore, it talks about a kind of a vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality in higher education to all. Its policy is founded on guiding principles and goals such as access, equity, quality, affordability, sustainability, and accountability. One of the most important aspects that merit mentioning in that education policy 2019 is built on a framework for the transformation and reinvigoration of the system of education to respond to fast-changing knowledge world in which Indian society being part by taking into account the diversity of Indian people, the tradition, culture, and languages. But it really took off, it embarked on a major assumption that it would bring about transformation by not recognizing the fact that India's educational landscape is premised on the system called caste. So the basic fulcrum of the Indian society that really hangs on is caste, the system of caste. So caste has five major categories: who has to be on top, who should be in the middle, and who should be at the bottom, and who should be outside. Therefore, the system regulates, and those who are born in those castes are getting the maximum privileges, status, and all the incentives. It is in this context, caste that functions on privileges, incentives, stratification, and differentiation. It is ably supported and reinforced by patriarchy, community caste, religion divides, and through other instrumentations. It also hoped that within the rubric of skill, ethical and social responsibility should fall in, so that India wants to acquire the status of being knowledge-based society. So it is in this context, how are we going to really look at inclusion, equity, and diversity in higher education? Because the recent data clearly shows that being India, a caste-ridden society, even in the second decade of the 21st century, caste is visible and permeated into all spheres of my society. We see caste-based privileges and guarantees in such a scenario. I think the National Education Policy 2019 should have taken caste more seriously, whereas it seemed to have subsumed some of the major dominating fulcrums as something not needed, and went on in many things. Therefore, the reports of the National Commission of the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes, Scheduled Castes means the untouchables, and the tribal communities, are a grim reminder that the vast majority of the untouchables and tribes remain poor, illiterate, lack the requisite skills for competing in the modern world, enjoy unequal access to productive resources, and remain deeply tied to land and transitional occupation, which offer limited possibilities of upward mobility. So once you are born in a particular caste, there is no exit. And once you are born as an untouchable or a tribe, there is no exit. You will have to live, and everything really geared around that. Therefore, if untouchables and scheduled tribes are provided good education, then the education itself may lead to the social mobility. These were the groups which were socially excluded in the Indian society for years together. Hence, education can serve as a catalyst for upward mobility. So therefore, this new national education policy gives primacy to education. But at the same time, when it comes to brass tacks, nothing can be worked out. Therefore, education really gives us the leverage for upward mobility. But within the caste system, can education bring this type of transformation? Therefore, when we look at the data, it is so annoying, so catastrophic, because both the untouchables and the tribals, the gap in genders within and between are too large, because the Dalits, the gender gap is about 24% when compared with the dominant caste categories by 16.3%. Therefore, when we look at some of the enrollment of eligible ratio and so on and so forth of the untouchables and the thing, they are at the bottom. So there is, so thus far, there has not been any upward mobility, because the system of caste doesn't allow upward mobility at all. Therefore, when we look at the whole data, I will give it to Regula a little later, you can look at it. The facts and figures, what does it infer? The vulnerable communities, especially the untouchables and the tribals, have not benefited at all, despite radical policies and programs, both from the Ministry of Human Resources and the University Grant Commission. These communities still face all sorts of discrimination, so on and so forth. Therefore, within this whole framework, if you look at it, this is how I look at inequality, because the theme talks about equality, but I am pitching this equality as against inequality. Therefore, when we talk about inequality, inequality reduces economic efficiency and traps societies in bad development paths through inequality perpetuating institutions in three ways. So inequality reduces the participation of the poor people in political processes, both directly and indirectly. This in turn reduces the likelihood that poor people have access to education, healthcare, and other services that would contribute to growth. Therefore, without these things, you cannot expect a kind of a good education at the higher level. Inequality can hinder the establishment of independent and impartial institutions and the enforcement of binding rules, because they might reduce the benefits of the privileged. Inequality makes it easier for the wealthy to hold on in political bargaining, either directly or through capital flight. It therefore makes it more difficult for societies to respond quickly and optimally to external shocks. So it is as against this backdrop, when we look at equality, lies in the conviction that each person is of infinite and hence equal worth and should be treated as such. This means that being human is far more important than differences of color, gender, class, creed, wealth, intelligence, nationality, and so forth. Therefore, when we talk about equality, I think equality is on a higher plane. And so to affirm human equality is both to say something important about what human beings are and also how relationships and social institutions should be arranged and how we should behave to one another. So in it is in that context, when we look at the equality, it is more ideational phenomenon, explains normative or valuation aspect of high and low relations, whereas inequality as a structural aspect, I think the previous presenter also talked about the structural injustices, the structural differentiation. Therefore, a structural aspect indicates are the existential conditions and differential distribution of and access to resources, how norms relating to inequality evolve, change, and influence social relation, who play a dominating role in the production of the world of thoughts, what are those aspects which are scarce and highly valued. So it is in this context, I think we need to look at this whole digital education. So when we talk about digital education, higher levels of education, there has been a digital divide within the country and between the countries. It is in this context, if you look at the data of the digitalization of the untouchables and the tribals, they are very, very backward. The data clearly shows 16 to 17% of these communities fall under digitalization. Most of them, majority of them are outside. So it is in this context, education is just one area that has highlighted the digital divide between India's rural and urban areas during the lockdown. During the pandemic, we can see, but at the same time, the digital corporations, the tech corporations have increased their profit by 600 times more. And if you look at the digital oligarchs, they have amassed wealth during these 18 months. So it is in this context, we'll have to see the world has been divided. The digital divide is very, very blatant and very obvious, very visible in the world. And in India, it is too visible. The trend is evident everywhere. Telemedicine, banking, e-commerce, e-governance, all of which became accessible only via the internet during the lockdown. The divide exists despite the rise in the number of wireless subscribers in India over the past few years. Hence, we see the urban-rural distinction is quite stark. Then if you look at 17, 18 data and of the now, the digital divide the gap between those who own, those who are within the digital thing and outside seem to be widening. So when we talk about the digital gender divide, India has among the world's highest gender gap in access to technology. Only 21% of women in India are mobile internet users, according to one government survey of 2020. Therefore, 42% of men have access. The report says that while 79% of men own a mobile phone in the country, the number for women is just 60%, while there are economic barriers to women and to young women, and also the other paraphernalia that you need, like laptop and other things, and which is also very culturally conditioned. So when we look at some of these digital divide, I think when you discuss tomorrow, I think the rural urban and male female and other divides need to be taken into consideration. So when we talk about the theme itself has a lot of assumptions, but how are we going to really translate these assumptions when we really put it into the context? So these are the major aspects that really surface. And as we move on, I think more and more clarity we may get from my side. I wanted to really, I always look at the whole problem from below. I am not a top-down man, but I always look from bottom. So how far? Because for me, the bottom has billions of people who have been negated the luxury of this whole digital thing. Therefore, so let us move on, peeling the issues one by one and see the issues objectively. Thank you.